Ah, I should have known it would be you. Word reached me of a struggle with a small but well-armed band of trespassers. Forgive my comrades their hostility. Few come here uninvited, and fewer still with good intent. Now, tell me why you are here. So, you seek to stem the Dravanian tide with talk? A romantic notion. If you but knew the truth, the spark which lit the flames of this animosity, you would understand the futility of your quest. Shall I relate it to you? The sordid history my gift has shown me, that which the Holy See has taken such pains to suppress. Was more than a millennium past when an Elizan tribe first sought to claim the lands of Kerthas as its home. Unfortunately for them, Kerthas was already home to dragonkind, and they were not inclined to make way for the invaders. Thus did a bloody war begin, a war which might well have rumbled on until one or the other side was exterminated, had it not been for the resolve of a single woman. That woman's name was Shiva. While those around her fought and died, she attempted to parley with the dragons, and in so doing discovered them to be possessed of profound intelligence and reason. The great worm Hraesvelgar, in particular, so enchanted Shiva that she found herself growing to love the creature, whom her people considered a monster. In the eyes of a near-immortal dragon, however, the fleeting life of an Elizan is as that of a freshly cut rose. Scarce has the flower bloomed before it begins to fade and wither. Such melancholy musings plagued Hraesvelgar, who had found in Shiva an unexpected and beloved soulmate. He knew that all too soon, death would snatch her away from him. Unable to bear the thought of their separation, the maid bid the worm consume her, that their spirits might be entwined for eternity. Though loath to perform the deed, Hraesvelgar ultimately gave in to her plea, and soon thereafter the tale of their ill-fated love spread throughout the two warring factions. No more could they raise blade or claw against one another, knowing that the souls of their kin were so inextricably bound. In the days that followed, man and dragon learned to live in harmony, and together built a nation unlike any the world had ever known. For 200 years did this blissful age of peace continue, as it would to this day, had vilest envy not stirred in the hearts of the Elizan. It is said that worms owe their longevity to the boundless reserves of vitality found within their eyes. And 'twas in this belief that a traitorous band of knights deceived their allies of some 2 centuries, and took by force that which they coveted. Nidhogg. He who now stands poised to unleash his wormlings upon Ishgard was the great dragon who lost an eye to Elizan treachery. And until he prizes it from the hands of the traitor's progeny, no amount of conciliatory words will stay his fury.
You are wrong, Lady Iceheart. Lest you misunderstand, I do not doubt your vision of the past. 'Tis true that Nidhogg greatly desired to reclaim the Eye. Indeed, it was for that very reason that I kept it with me as I roamed the land, attempting to draw him away from the city. gods! Until recently, Nidhogg seemed unable to resist its allure and pursued me relentlessly. Needless to say, that is no longer the case. Now, it would seem, he has fixed his attention on Ishgard itself, though he knows full well the Eye does not reside there.
You believe he targets the capital for another reason?
I believe reason has all but left him. Through the Eye, I feel much of what Nidhogg feels. And the dragon's thirst for vengeance will not be quenched by aught less than a sea of blood.
If Nidhogg is indeed lost to reason, might we not seek an audience with Hraesvelgr instead? He has thus far shown no inclination to aid in the invasion of Ishgard, and may yet welcome our efforts to broker a peace.
You still believe that a peaceable solution can be found? Very well. I will take you to him. Our road will lead us to Dravania, the homeland of dragonkind. There we shall ascend unto the clouds, where Hraesvelgr resides.
Is aught amiss, my friend? I sense the many battles are beginning to take their toll. Rest a while, and should you lose sight of us, Dravania lies beyond the mountains to the west.
Curious. The vestiges of thy mistress's blessing are not as faint as once they were. Thy will to succeed grants thee unusual fortitude, but will it be enough?
Beyond Abalathia's spine, the great mountain range that spans the continent of Aldenard from east to west. Into the deepening shadows of Som'ahl, where lies the ancient home of dragonkind. To a land where the soil slithers and the skies seethe with sinuous shapes, they came.
Thank you. Thank you.
Fafnir!
Ah, 'tis thee, little one. From above, I did mistake thee for an earth. 'Tis well I chanced to look again, or thou wouldst now be ash.
Dear Vidofnir, how I have missed you. Would that I had come sooner, and not out of dire necessity.
Thou art troubled. Speak that I might know thy plight. Thou wouldst have father admonish his brood brother.
I would end this war without further bloodshed.
How am I to believe thee, little one, when thine own companion beareth Nidhogg's stolen eye?
Have care, dragon, or I shall gouge out one of yours.
You forget yourself, sir. We are here on a mission of peace.
My sire's will forbiddeth me from inviting discord to our home. 'Tis for this reason and no other that thou still drawest breath, knight.
Vidofnir, please. We must be allowed to convey our intentions to Hraesvelgar in person, with words of our own choosing. Grant us this favor, and open the way to Somme Arl.
Thou hast ever been welcome, little one. But I cannot grant thy wish. I am bound to remain here, and protect my kin from the Nath's god.
The Nath have summoned a primal.
Pray excuse my forwardness, but if we were to eliminate the threat to your territory, would you consent to Lady Izzel's request?
Ha! Dost thou imagine thyself equal to the task? To succeed where dragons have failed? Tis beyond thee, mortal. But thou art welcome to try, nonetheless. Only know that idle promises shall avail thee naught.
It would seem we have no choice but to make good on Alfino's offer. Why must our every bid for peace breed yet more war?